Hello and welcome to Dispatches from India, where we look at key news developments from across the country. We start out with our News This Week segment, where we bring you key news developments often not covered by the corporate media, but which reflect what is happening in India. Our first story has to do with Afghanistan, but it's from right here, the national capital of India, Delhi. The eyes of the world are on Afghanistan after the quick takeover by the Taliban. There are innumerable questions about its future, the human rights situation, and what will be the status of women and minorities. Most analysts have pointed out that India has suffered a strategic blow with the Taliban takeover, as it has not really established any ties with them. The Taliban are also backed by Pakistan, which is likely to reduce India's maneuvering ability in Afghanistan. Indians are being evacuated from the country, and there have been some reports that the Taliban stopped some Indians from returning. Meanwhile, Afghan refugees who are in India are deeply disturbed about the situation back home, and feel that there is little chance of their ever returning back to their country. NewsClick spoke to some of them in Delhi.
Afghanistan par Taliban ke kabze ke baad ab Delhi mein reh rahe Afghani refugees apne ghar apne desh wapas jane ki ummeed chhod chuke hain.
This new government has been long anticipated. It was meant to take place. We had talked that it could have taken place.
Jab tak main Afghanistan mein tha, mera kaam बहुत अच्छा था, मेरा प्राइवेट बिजनेस था. जो 2013 में ये अमेरिकन लोगों का जाना जाना स्टार्ट हो गई, उसी में पूरे अफगानिस्तान में काम धंधा सब बंद हो गई. मेरा खुद में करोड़ों रुपये उधर नुकसान हो गई. अभी जो तालिबान इसको पकड़ दिए, ये तो बिल्कुल ही मेरे मन में नहीं आ रहा कि मैं वापस जाने के लिए. मेरा मूड बनते कि मैं वापस जाऊँगा, क्योंकि तालिबान पहले भी इधर वही अफगानिस्तान में आ गया. पाँच साल पूरा लोगों को परेशान रख दिया. अभी तालिबान वही तालिबान है.
तालिबान दावा कर रहा है कि वो बदल चुका है और इस बार वो एक प्रोग्रेसिव रुख अपनाएगा. प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंस में तालिबान की ओर से कहा गया है कि वो महिलाओं को शरिया कानून के तहत अधिकार और आजादी देंगे. उन्होंने कहा कि महिलाएं हेल्थ सेक्टर और स्कूलों में काम कर सकेंगी.
हम यहाँ आया फैमिली की वजह से आया. हमारा फैमिली सब है, बच्चे सब है. वहाँ अफगानिस्तान में कोई प्रॉब्लम है, स्कूल नहीं जा सकते और काम नहीं कर सकते. तेरे पास पैसा हो तुझे उठाएगा, तुझे नहीं उठा सकता, तेरे बच्चे को उठाएगा. इस सिस्टम में मेरे बीबी शहीद हो गए. $50,000 मांगता था, पहले गलती किया, $5,000 मांगा, वो लोग को दिया, फिर $10,000 दिया, फिर $50,000 के डिमांड किया, हम नहीं दिया. मैं इंग्लैंड में था 2012 में, इसलिए मेरा बीबी का दिन 3:30 था. अफगानिस्तान न्यूज़ सब कुछ में है. 3:30 उसके कत्ल में शहीद किया पैसों के चक्कर में.
दिल्ली के अफगान रेफ्यूजीज पल दर पल अपनों का हाल जानने के लिए बेसब्र हैं. वो हर सेकंड ये सोच के चिंतित हैं कि वो अपनों को दोबारा देख भी पाएंगे या नहीं.
Our next story is from the state of Tamil Nadu, where disabled people organized and held a protest recently on the withdrawal of facilities in special trains. Many of these trains were introduced during the pandemic, and disability rights activists say that concessions provided to them in regular trains were removed, leading to greater difficulties for them, both in terms of access and financially. Here is a report of the protests and the reasons for it.
Tamil Nadu Association for the Rights of All Types of Differently Abled and Caregivers, TARATEC, has conducted a statewide protest. It is August 11 across Tamil Nadu. The protest has been conducted over 72 centers in Tamil Nadu against the victimization and facilities curtailed by the railways and the union governments. For the last 1.5 years, that is from March 2020, the COVID pandemic has started, and the invoke of the lockdown. Many trains running across the state and all over the country has been running in the name of special trains. After the invoke of the lockdown during the COVID pandemic, the facilities, the concessions already given by the government, railway and the union railway ministry and the government has been stopped, and the fare folded at 2 times or at 3 times. The concessional fare also for concessional facilities has been refused, and the fare has been folded twice or thrice, and people like disabled senior citizens and the children has really troubled to travel, and they have been their movement has been restricted. Almost all the important railway stations, the lifts and the escalators has been halted, and boarded itself that it is in an out of order. So the facilities which has been withdrawn and curtailed, and it has been stopped to the passengers and commuters, which was earlier enjoyed by the passengers and the travelers. The Tamil Nadu Association for the Rights of All Types of Differently Abled and Caregivers has conducted a statewide protest against the Union Railway Ministry to withdraw the names of the special trains, and we demand the Railway Department to run their trains as it was earlier before the lockdown.
We now move to our In Focus section, where we take a deeper look at the issues Indians are talking about. August 15th was India's Independence Day. On 1947, after a prolonged freedom struggle, the British colonizers were forced to leave the country on this day. India's independence was a historic moment and inspired many anti-colonial movements across the world. However, it also came with immense pain, as the country was split into India and Pakistan, and millions became refugees, and there was large-scale migration, death and despair. As India is in its 75th year of independence, there have been many analyses about the direction the country has taken. While India has remained a democracy and has seen many achievements, the questions remain as to whether the promise of independence has been fulfilled for a majority of its people, especially the poor. On this issue, we first bring you a discussion between NewsClick's editor-in-chief Prabir Purkayastha and economist Prabhat Patnaik on India's economy and the approach of the current government during the pandemic.
Mr. Modi seems to have promised 100 trillion rupees investment on energy and renewable energy, doing away with various shortages, as well as coal-based energy, at least in large amounts. How do you take this promise of next 25 years compared to what we are doing at the moment?
No, the point is that the government's entire thinking on investment and on the economy is, I believe, incorrect. The government believes that it has to make an investment out of the resources it has, because it cannot spend beyond its means, in quotes. And the means are limited because it is not willing to tax the rich. Now, it's for this reason that you find that the government, that the Prime Minister has been making promises, for instance, about infrastructure investment. He has been making promises for the last three Independence Day speeches. During the last three Independence Day speeches, he has been making the same promise, but nothing has come of it. So, you know, these are simply things which he promises, but nothing actually comes of it, and nothing is, I believe, going to come of even his latest promise. And this is for this reason, that during the pandemic, while almost every other country, certainly every other country in the first world, was making transfer payments, universal transfer payments to all its citizens during the period of lockdown and even afterwards, including even Donald Trump in the United States, India is one of the few countries that made absolutely no such payments. There were some targeted groups to whom some pittance was given, but there was no universal payments, as indeed was the case with all other countries. India's transfers to the poor have been most niggardly. Now, again, it's the same thinking, namely, if we cannot augment our resources, then we cannot spend. It's exactly like the fact that we have a certain limited budget and we have to stick to that budget. And it is that thinking which is wrong economically, and it has had disastrous consequences.
At the moment also, we have a extra burden on the people, because due to COVID-19, we have really a huge loss of jobs. We have seen the poverty figures grow up significantly. the weakest sections in society have borne the major brunt of the COVID-19 pandemic.
Oh, absolutely. In fact, many people, economists, civil society organizations, political parties have been demanding that it is not only for the benefit of the poor, but even for a revival of the economy, the government must hand over purchasing power to the people through an income transfer scheme. You see, because during the pandemic, because the government did not hand over any such purchasing power, unlike in other countries, people got into debt. And when they got into debt, they have to now, even if you provide them with income, they have to repay that debt. Therefore, they will not be able to spend as much. Therefore, the multiplier value of the incomes they get is extremely limited. So even if you have a revival of the economy, that revival would be stillborn. That revival would in fact peter out. And that's why everybody has been saying that, look, you must hand over purchasing power to the people so that over and above anything that they may get by way of their income, there must be. So the whole argument that, look, now that the lockdown is over, now that the pandemic is over, now that people are going to get their jobs back because the economy is going to automatically revive, let us actually not talk anymore in terms of transfers to them. That entire argument is completely wrong, because that would mean that even if people get their incomes, there would be a stillborn recovery.
The right-wing Bharatiya Janata Party has been in power since 2014 and has brought about quite a few changes to Indian society with its emphasis on Hindu nationalist politics. This has often clashed with the secularism that was a hallmark of the freedom struggle. Eminent journalist Prem Shankar Jha talks about his view of the future of the country while in conversation with senior journalist Paranjay Guha Thakurta.
I am profoundly disappointed, and I would say I'm close to despairing for the future of our country.
The occasion is the 75th anniversary of India's independence. Why are you so despondent? I mean, let me divide this question into two parts. What do you think is likely to happen when the next general elections take almost 3 years away? We are looking at April, May of 2024. That's the near term, so to say. And when you look ahead beyond 2024, I mean, are you as despondent? Do you remain as pessimistic? Do you think the future of this country, we describe ourselves as the world's largest democracy, is very, very bleak?
Well, first, let me be just slightly, elaborate what I said earlier. My despair is on the economy. My despair is not on the people of India. On the contrary, I see a kind of a flowering of an intelligentsia, which I think there are very few countries in the world that have, you know, and it's happening because the intelligentsia is feeling threatened by what is happening in the government today. You know, that is one. Second, the degree of innovativeness in small industry, you know, in farmers. I've been studying the farm problem very closely for the last 9 months because it has happened. And there are many solutions, and the farmers are beginning to find some of them themselves without Mr. Modi's help. But their agriculture has been in a crisis precisely because farmers are so phenomenally successful in the past. We have a crisis of massive overproduction in just about everything, which is why you can't suddenly wipe out all market protections for the producers and say, we're going to create a free market, because in a free market of surplus, the producers' prices will be driven down into the ground and they will die one by one. So, you know, I think that the people of India will come to their senses, and I see that, and they will join together either to bring the BJP RSS to its senses or to vote at an opposition coalition into power. There is a realization that issues now matter, that India's future matters. it is being promoted, it has been created precisely by that intelligence you were talking about. You okay. look at the Twitter, you know, and WhatsApp and so on, and look at the alternate press and see what's happening.
Our next story is about the confluence of people's struggles when two iconic movements met. The Narmada Bachao Andolan, or the Save Narmada movement, turned 37 years old recently. It is a movement organized by tribal communities and farmers against dam projects on the Narmada River, which passes through central India. The protesters feared large-scale displacement and destruction of the habitat in the region, and their movement became iconic as one of the leading environmental struggles of India in the 90s and the 2000s. While the Sardar Sarovar Dam project, which was the focus of the protests, finally was inaugurated in 2017, the movement remained a milestone in India's history of environmentalism. In order to mark the anniversary of the movement, a People's Assembly was held recently. Among the key participants were leaders of the ongoing struggle against the three controversial farm laws. Now, farmers say that these laws will reduce the prices they get and increase the corporate role in agriculture. Many drew connection between the Narmada struggle and the farmers' protest, which has been going on since November 2020. We bring you the sights and sounds of this People's Assembly, which took place in the state of Madhya Pradesh.
जल जंगल जमीन पे उसी का अधिकार हो जो वर्षों से उसकी पीढ़ी यहाँ पे रहती हुई आ रही है। नर्मदा नदी पे जो बांध बन रहे हैं उनसे यहाँ के लोगों को उजाड़ा जा रहा है, यहाँ के मछुआरों को उजाड़ा जा रहा है, उनके गांव बस्ती को उजाड़ा गया है। यहाँ पे विस्थापित के नाम पे अभी बहुत काम होना बाकी है। उस आंदोलन को आज 36 साल हो गए, तो उस आंदोलन के 36वीं सालगिरह पे यहाँ पे हम आए।
आंदोलन का बड़े आंदोलन का पार्ट है जो एक इतिहास में दर्ज हो रहा है, आप उसका भविष्य क्या देखते हैं? सरकार भी बात कर चुकी, सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने उसको होल्ड पे भी रख दिया है, क्या एंड देख रहे हैं आप उसका?
इसमें देश की जनता की जीत होगी, एंड क्या होगा उसका? कोई ये सृष्टि खत्म हो जाएगी, सरकारें बचेगी? इन सरकारों को वो कानून वापसी लेने पड़ेंगे।
किसान कॉन्ट्रैक्ट फार्मिंग की बात कर रहे हैं ये लोग, भाई हमारे इतने बिचौले व्यापारी हैं जिससे उन सभी को रोजगार मिल रहे हैं। पहले ही रोजगार की इस मध्य प्रदेश में दिक्कत है, तो अब ये जो काम कर रहे हैं इन लोगों को भी रोजगार से अगर हटाते हैं तो और भी रोजगार की समस्या खड़ी हो जाएगी।
आज यहाँ बड़वानी में नर्मदा बचाओ आंदोलन के 36 वर्ष पूरे होने पर इस विशेष किसान मजदूर जन संसद का आयोजन किया गया है। वो एक तरह से किसान आंदोलन के इतिहास में, इस इलाके के किसानों के इतिहास में मील का पत्थर है, क्योंकि नर्मदा बचाओ आंदोलन ने इस देश के आंदोलनों को एक नई भाषा दी, किसान की एक नई परिभाषा दी है, आंदोलन की नई व्याकरण दी है और लड़ने की एक नई ग्रामर दी है। उससे पूरे देश के किसान जुड़ा नहीं है और अब किसान और मजदूर के गठबंधन को अलग नहीं किया जा सकता।
कानून धड़ाधड़ पास कर रहे हैं इन, ये बंद होंगे और देश की जनता की आवाज को उनको सुनना पड़ेगा।
That's all we have time for today. We'll be back next week with more news from India. Until then, keep watching People's Dispatch.